organizations are giving this opportunity to moderate the session. The topic itself is very interesting, undifferentiated tropical fever, especially with COVID presenting in various ways. So sometimes it's possible that we miss the common things which are occurring, and all these, now of course I heard from morning at that time from Dr. Thangavelu, dengue is the main admission in Mehta Hospital. So there is a wonderful person, Karthik Nalasamy, Associate Professor in PGMH Chandigarh. Of course, Chandigarh being one of the most premier institutions, taking the best of talents from all over India. So I'm sure all of them who have been trained in the intensive care unit pediatrics, they are shining very well in various places. Of course, you know all the examples who have been talking in Ramesh Kumar, Sashidharan, and of course Malai. All of them have been trained, and it's one of the best centers. And there is no other better person to talk about it, because he's interested in this tropical infections, acute care, diabetic ketoacidosis, ventilation meaning. So I will not stand in between you and the speaker. Dr. Karthik Nalasamy, I'm very happy that I am sharing your session. Please come in. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It's a pleasure to present under session chaired by you. And I hope I'm audible on my...
Yeah, you're audible.
Audible.
And I thank at the outset the Tamil Nadu IAP for this wonderful opportunity. In fact, one of my friend jokingly called me, seeing at the brochure that I'm the foreign body, because I don't belong to Chennai anymore. But thank you for establishing the connection with the previous two chairpersons. So with that, I'll move on to the talk, Undifferentiated Tropical Fevers, Approach in Post-COVID Era. When Dr. Sashidharan contacted me for this talk, I particularly like this optimism in the title, Post-COVID Era, where the COVID is done and dusted, according to him, and we are going to see only the post-COVID problems. I hope it remains that way. So what I'm going to cover in the next 30 minutes would be undifferentiated presentation of a tropical fever, particularly in a ICU setting or an emergency setting. And I hope some of the things are not applicable to OPD practice. And here I'm going to talk about more of a severe variety of undifferentiated tropical fever. Again, I'm saying that I'm not going to deal with individual infections. So if you are able to diagnose individual infections at the outset, then you don't need to worry about this presentation or this approach. And it is going to be only a reasonable approach, and a region-specific data is going to be presented. So it can be modified according to your own epidemiological profile. And my part two would be about post-COVID era, where MISC, how it overlaps with tropical fevers, and in a child who presents with any other acute illness who's antibody positive, how we deal with it. I'm going to touch upon it briefly in the later part. So to draw your attention, I start with a case who presented recently to our emergency unit. Miss Kate, 10-year-old girl, traveled around about 3.5 hours from a district from Haryana, and reached in mid-August, close to midnight. And she presented about 2 months after the COVID has touched the baseline in the Haryana region. So it is fairly, Missy was just tailing out. We didn't see MISC at this point of time, many cases. So she had fever for about 5 days. Initially started as moderate to high grade fever, and then the intensity reduced quite a bit. And by day three, she developed pain abdomen, dull aching, and non-bilious vomiting. With that, in the next 1 or 2 days, she progressed into altered sensorium with behavioral alteration, progressing into a relatively advanced sensorium alteration. With that, just before presentation, the parents noticed facial puffiness, and she was passing less urine. She had reduced oral intake, irrelevant talk, and which culminated into poor GCS at the time of presentation. There was no history of rash or bleeding manifestations, no history of COVID in her or any contact in the recent past. She was a well-thriving, normal child without any pre-morbid illness. She was admitted for a day in a medical college locally and managed acute encephalitis since she presented an altered consciousness state, received ceftriaxone acyclovir, and developed renal failure, so he was referred to our center. So at admission, her airway was unstable naturally because of poor GCS. Her score was around 6, and she had tachypnea, although not hypoxemic. She had tachycardia, but blood pressures were on the higher centile, and icterus was noticed on physical examination, and there was periorbital edema as well. So with this presentation, she was labeled as airway instability and seen as dysfunction, and classified as resuscitation. Our further systemic examination revealed hepatomegaly, which was 4 cm below right costal margin. The span was not mentioned in the file, but she did not have any spleen palpable. And there was hypertonia with the brisk deep tendon reflexes and plantars were upgoing. So with this background, I probably ask you to interact with me in the chat box. You can write your differential diagnosis. What is the common process you consider with this clinical history, and then we go one by one. Now, so this is an acute febrile illness with predominantly neurological presentation, but she had systemic signs like edema, jaundice, and hepatomegaly, and possibly multi-organ dysfunction. We need to get labs to confirm that. So the initial possibility entertained by the ER team was scrub typhus based on epidemiology, which is quite common here, more common than dengue. And because of icterus and encephalopathy, viral hepatitis was also considered strongly. Leptospirosis, although possible, quite possible because of hepatic and renal involvement, but the epidemiology is such that we have hardly seen any case in the past 5 years or so. So we don't see such many cases, so it was not considered upfront, and encephalitis was also kept in the card, although she had systemic manifestations. So in the first hour, she was intubated and put on bag and tube ventilation, didn't get a ventilator immediately, started on sedonalgesia and hypertonic saline bolus and infusion, started on ceftriaxone and doxycycline pending lab results. So by day, and this is the blood gas, which is showing compensated metabolic acidosis with the lactate borderline elevation. And the X-ray was done in the first 1 or 2 hours, which showed relatively normal lung, but you can see the right pleural effusion here. So this was the positive findings. So with this X-ray, again, the treating unit had a confusion. By the time she developed hypotension after intubation, so received a normal saline bolus, a dengue malaria card point of care test was done, which were negative. So she was, her fluids are converted to isotonic fluids from a half normal saline, which is the standard of care in our unit. So considering dengue as one of the possibilities, it was changed to isotonic fluids. And by 6 hours, we had some labs available, which showed a hemoglobin of 12, which is slightly higher. We would say probably a PCV hematocrit was around 39-40. So possibly, again, dengue could be there. But there is coagulopathy, bilirubin elevation, which is not super high, but 3.8, and transaminitis in thousands. So there is evidence of acute liver failure. Also acute kidney injury with a creatinine of 4.5. So at this juncture, hepatic failure and hepatic encephalopathy was strongly considered. So N-acetylcysteine infusion was started, which is practiced still in case-to-case basis in our unit, and along with other liver supportive therapies. By 19 hours, she could get a bed in PICU with a ventilator, so she was shifted to PICU. So again, we can pause here and you can revise your differential diagnosis. You can type in the chat box, what do you think? So at the time of PICU transfer, the primary diagnosis considered was viral hepatitis with hepatic encephalopathy. Scrub, because being a multi-organ failure at the outset within 5 days. So scrub was also considered, although lower down on the cards, and lepto, dengue, because ruled in because of the X-ray findings and a bit of higher hemoglobin, but platelets were fairly okay, probably doesn't look like. And meningeal encephalitis was fairly ruled out because of multi-organ failure, which generally we don't see with encephalitis. So further in the PICU, she received vasoactive therapy, ventilation, doxy and ceftriaxone. Ceftriaxone was stopped after a few days, and these were the further investigations. So ammonia was borderline high. CRP was neither there, whether bacterial or viral. It's not discriminating, although looks towards bacterial. And ferritin was elevated, LDH was high, malaria was negative. And further post, she improved over the next 3 days with supportive care, and we were able to extubate and put her on NIV, and then further we into and shift her to ward. These were the lab reports. From day 2 to 4, we got further hemograms, which showed improving platelets, improving transaminases, ammonia has improved, creatinine has improved. She didn't require renal replacement therapy. So what is the diagnosis at this point? So we did send diagnostic workup, and there came the confusion. So blood culture, no growth. And in the same order, we received the investigations. By day 3, we got dengue, which was positive. Streptococcus ELISA was positive. And hepatitis A IgM, which was obtained on day 5 or so, which was again positive. So what is the diagnosis? Again, you can type in your comments. What is what do you think as primary diagnosis? So some I can show you the provisional discharge summary made by our residents. You can see the right hand corner. There is a confusion. So hepatic NCAF with AKA stage 3. Acute viral hepatitis primary diagnosis, but dengue and streptococcus co-infection. I personally believe it is unlikely, and it is not there. And the final summary it got corrected, but I think this confusion existed throughout the course at some point. Although clinical discretion, clinical judgment is very important, and it is the hallmark of any clinician or a physician. But while working in intensive care, probably you lose touch or you rely on gadgets, or at sometimes children present with non-specific signs or atypical manifestations, that acquiring a diagnosis is quite difficult. So that sets the topic for today: tropical fevers with an undifferentiated presentation. There are several terminologies used in the literature, so all of them probably denote the same. And I'm not going to talk about PUO, which is entirely a different category with consensus definition, which is there since 1960s. So coming to the definition, our group, probably headed by Dr. Singhi, put out a management guideline which defined tropical fevers, and I further refined it here with the current knowledge. So it is just any fever which is less than 2 weeks duration without any localizing signs, where you can't localize organ specific infection, and there is organ system involvement or organ failure at the outset, one or more, for presenting generally to the emergency department. And also they might have systemic features such as rash, edema, hepatomegaly, or an encephalopathy, with a seasonal trend in incidence, which strongly points out towards a tropical fever. So what are the common infections which we see? Dengue and streptococcus. I think all over India, these are the two common infections with differing proportions. I hope it is same in Tamil Nadu as well. And also we see enteric fever, malaria in some proportion, and leptospirosis based on the region we are working. And other probably single system involvement, which can present with multi-organ failure at times and creates confusions, like encephalitis, H1N1 pneumonia, viral hepatitis, and liver failure, encephalopathy, or a classic bacterial sepsis, a gram-negative sepsis. In an advanced stage, it is difficult to differentiate when they present in a particular season. And the flavor of the current season, MISC, which again poses confusion because it presents with, it's a febrile, acute febrile presentation with organ failures. So why do we need this kind of a management guideline and approach to tropical fever necessary when we have so many individual infection guidelines from so many renowned national and international societies? The problem with these tropical fevers, particularly those present to emergency department, is that the clinical presentation is often overlapping, and especially when they present with organ failures, and some of them have atypical manifestations which overlaps with other common presentation of a common illness. And sometimes we may see a co-infection. Again, this is difficult to discern with serological test alone, but some of them can have co-infection because of a seasonal predilection. So if you see the guidelines for dengue, and this is the in the left hand side, you can see the scrub typhus profile presenting to ICU, lot of overlap with organ failures. So encephalitic presentation, fulminant hepatic failure, renal failure, cardiac dysfunction, or an ARDS like presentation, quite common in both. And when they present with organ failures, it is difficult to differentiate. And the problem in laboratory investigation is that it is often confirmed by serology. Most of the tests, most of the infections are diagnosed with serological tests, which will take some time to obtain. So in the initial few days, you don't have a result. And there are point of care tests like dengue and malaria, but many of the test kits are not standardized, and over reliability on these kits may overestimate or underestimate the problem because of false positive and false negative results. And if you test in a particular period of an illness, like if you test IgM and dengue within 5 days of illness, you may get a false negative reaction, and a false positive reaction may occur because of the child living in endemic area and having a previous infection. And more importantly, peripheral setups, or even in tertiary care or a secondary level setups, we don't have adequate investigations to diagnose or confirm these infections, like a PCR-based or molecular-based diagnostic facilities. And coming to the treatment problems, again, we need to start acting early, hit all the possible infections early, because if they present in organ failure, every hard delay in instituting specific therapy would compromise the outcome. And at the same time, if we give multiple antimicrobials, then with their underlying organ failure, hepatic or renal dysfunction, the side effects of the toxicity would be higher. And there is no the problematic one is more, there is no uniform guidelines based on the region specific epidemiology. So we need to rely on our own data, or probably synthesize our own data. So with this background, the group in 2014 advocated for a syndromic approach in delineating the etiology. So they broadly classified the tropical fevers with their organ failures. So fever without any organ failures, fever with thrombocytopenia or rash, and then respiratory distress or ARDS, CNS, and multi-organ failures. So if we classify them with the syndrome groups, probably we can prioritize our etiologies, like etiological workup. Some of them are more common with some type of presentations. For example, fever with ARDS like presentation with the systemic features, probably scrub typhus is more common than a dengue, whereas profound thrombocytopenia and bleeding is more common with dengue as compared to scrub typhus. And if they present with multi-organ failure, it is difficult to differentiate. So whether this kind of syndromic approach works or not, subsequently, in the next few years, the same group evaluated in a multi-center study of all tropical infections and their presenting syndromes. So if you can see, about 450 patients, both adults and children, were included, and about 170 were children. And you can see about 10% of the children and adults were contributed by Tamil Nadu from three centers. So in this study, what they found, it indeed had a seasonal predilection. So between July and November were the commonest season for these tropical fevers to present to emergency department and ICUs. And dengue was the most common, followed by scrub typhus. This is both the adult and the pediatric data, followed by encephalitis, particularly in northern states, and then malaria. It's heartening to see malaria is less common, about less than 10%, and other common infections, including bacterial sepsis, pneumonias, and leptospirosis. So again, one thing to note from this graph is that about 20% of the patients, we were not able to make a diagnosis. This is quite common. So this is where probably an approach and an empiric treatment helps, where you don't get an etiological diagnosis, but still you need to treat the basic disease as well as the organ failures. Coming to the syndromic presentation, again, I just, it's a busy slide, but you can just have a look at the highlighted or the circled portions. The commonest ones are circled. So fever with thrombocytopenia was the commonest syndromic presentation among all patients. And dengue had 91% of the children or adults, children and adults had thrombocytopenia as compared to about 2/3 in strep typhus. Whereas respiratory distress was much more common with strep typhus. And obviously encephalopathy, about 90% or more had, those with meningitis or encephalitis had encephalopathy about 90%. But here the important point to look at is about 1/4 of children with strep typhus, children or adults with strep typhus had encephalopathy. So an encephalitic presentation of strep typhus was seen in about 1/4 of all patients. And malaria had jaundice, and MODS was common with bacterial sepsis, and all patients had jaundice with viral hepatitis. So this would give a rough idea about a syndromic presentation and possibly the common etiology. So if you look at it in a different way, in a different graph, where among all patients with fever and thrombocytopenia, if you see strep typhus, which is blue, and the gray one, dengue, were the most common. If you include encephalopathy along with fever and thrombocytopenia, then strep typhus is the commoner one along with encephalitis. So if you see respiratory distress, again, strep typhus and dengue, some of the dengue form the most common cohort of fever, thrombocytopenia, and respiratory distress. Multi-organ dysfunction is shared by all, including strep typhus, dengue, and other infections. So these are about clinical presentation and syndromes. So is there a way to initially distinguish these infections with the help of laboratory investigation, basic laboratory investigation? So again, a busy slide, a serial investigation. This slide is taken from only pediatric cohort, about 146 children presented to our center. So if you see again the highlighted portion, dengue presented with hemoconcentration. So any hemoglobin above 12 or 13, think of dengue as compared to other illness if you have differentials. Malaria had anemia, a hemoglobin of 7 or less. And coming to platelets, profound thrombocytopenia was common with the dengue. And scrub also had thrombocytopenia, but probably a little higher than dengue. And if you see, the dengue after admission had progressively falling platelet counts. So these are some of the soft pointers. Again, we can augment, we can take these to augment our clinical judgment. So the total leukocyte counts are the highest with sepsis and where there is no diagnosis, but even children with strep typhus also had higher leukocyte count as compared to a dengue or an enteric fever where you see leukopenia. So other biochemistry, hypoalbuminemia was fairly common with scrub and dengue. Severe hypoalbuminemia, or a profound hypoalbuminemia with an albumin of less than 2.5 was seen almost half of the scrub typhus cases. And transaminases elevation, more than 50%, and scrub and dengue, more than 80%. So with this knowledge of clinical and laboratory parameters, probably this is a rough table, probably a suggested table, which would highlight the important features to distinguishing features between these infections. Like a fever greater than 7 days, a second week presentation is more common with scrub typhus, and they present with more often with the pulmonary infiltrates and respiratory distress or an ARDS. SHR, of course, pathognomonic and clinches the diagnosis of strep typhus. And leukopenia with enteric fever, high lactate, hypoglycemia in malaria. So these are, I think, the clinical knowledge which we already have. I just summarized it in this table. So with this, again, I will come back to the approach in treatment. So once you have a child with a suspected tropical fever where you ruled out localizing infection, what do you do? So assess the clinical syndrome, look at your epidemiology, what is your own hospital's common cases and what you don't see often, and classify them into syndromes. So we'll see fever with encephalopathy in a different algorithm. So all other syndromes, if they present with fever and any of the other organ failures apart from encephalopathy, the most of them will require an essential investigations which you often send, including a blood culture, which is very useful for diagnosing enteric fever and other basic hematological and biochemistry workup. And rapid diagnostic tests, malaria is recommended or advocated, and you can do malarial card test with appropriate antigen kits, and which can rule in malaria definitely or rule out, but the sensitivity and specificity are close to 90s 95, but we of course follow it up with smears, and these are probably point of care tests. Once you diagnose malaria, possibly you treat with artesunate and follow up with smears. And dengue card is not recommended, but because of ELISA based tests are preferred, NS1 and IgM. But if you don't have a resource for ELISA based tests, probably you can rely on a bit with caution the dengue card test. And if you don't have a diagnosis at the outset, then the empiric choice, a reasonable empiric choice, would be ceftriaxone and doxycycline, so which will cover your bacterial infection, enteric fever, meningitis, crop typhus, and so most of the common illnesses. And if doxy you are not it's not available, probably azithromycin, but our unit prefers doxycycline, and probably most of the centers for crop typhus prefer doxy over azithro, although azithro is possibly not inferior. And further workup based on whatever you are suspecting. And sometimes if you suspect hemophagocytosis, maybe a bone marrow culture would examination and culture would help. And if the child presents with fever and encephalopathy without any systemic signs, and you're suspecting meningitis or an encephalitis, and there is no contraindications for lumbar puncture, proceed with lumbar puncture and treat accordingly. And if you are not able to perform lumbar puncture, and particularly if the Glasgow Coma scale is less than 8 or 9, then possibly they need an imaging. A CECT is easier to obtain. And the empirical choice would be ceftriaxone along with azacyclovir if you're suspecting encephalitis, or doxycycline if you're suspecting scrub typhus based on your systemic features, hepatomegaly, liver dysfunction, hypoalbuminemia, or thrombocytopenia, then possibly doxy, because we have seen about a third or one fourth of cases can have encephalitic presentation. So that summarizes the approach and how we fared in the same cohort of 146 children. I'm just showing you what we did, and although it is a retrospective review, ceftriaxone and doxy were the most commonly used. About more than 3/4 of children received ceftriaxone and doxy in about half of them. And we also used, you can see we also used other agents, but probably less commonly. So this again helps you in treating and or creating an empiric choice, and probably avoiding unnecessary antibiotics, or tailoring it to only those specific cases where you suspect a different etiology. And coming to appropriateness, again, ceftriaxone doxy is not the final word, because if you start it, some of the dengues might receive these two drugs which are not required in them. Some of the scrubs or many of the scrubs would receive ceftriaxone, which is not required, but probably it is a reasonable empiric choice if you don't have a specific diagnosis at the outset. So that's about the approach or reasonable way of managing an undifferentiated tropical fever. So the confusion comes here with MISC, which is again a febrile presentation with organ failures. So the objective of this talk is just to sensitize you how common or uncommon these problems, and take an informed decision, because there is no clear cut guideline on this. So MISC, in addition to an excellent presentation by Balaji, I just add few more points. MISC is quite rare. If you see published data from USA, of course we don't have epidemiological data from India, the national data, but early in the pandemic, it was about 0.6%. That is, one in every 400 children of COVID positive children would develop MISC. And later on, most recent data, if you look at the total COVID cases, laboratory confirmed COVID cases in USA, 38 sorry, 38 lakhs, and the missing reported is around 4,000. So that roughly translates into 0.1. So one in every 1,000 children who are exposed to SARS-CoV-2 would develop MISC. So that's quite rare. So it is possibly that we may unlikely to see a case of MISC beyond a large not beyond a large COVID wave. So in fact, in our setup for the past 2 months, we did not encounter any case of MISC. So still, infections are more common. Dengue and scrub typhus are much more common than MISC. That's the point here. And MISC is a diagnosis of exclusion, as amply discussed in the previous talk. So any child with fever, raised CRP, and GI symptoms, and one lab abnormality would qualify for organ dysfunction, and MISC will be diagnosed. So although this child may not require any intervention, as pointed out by Dr. Balasubramanian in his talk. So the best time to evaluate for these children during MISC evaluation would be probably between 2 and 5 days, where we can evaluate and rule out all other tropical infections, and before embarking on treating with steroids or IVIG if they are stable. And there is a paper which, although from Western data, which is quite interesting. If you see a MISC cohort and fever of other etiologies presenting to ED, those who presented with mucocutaneous changes like extremity changes, conjunctivitis, had more often diagnosed with MISC as compared to lymphadenopathy or pharyngitis. So that's probably one clinical distinction. And MISC children, to the left, the graph shows fever of higher grade, about 39 to 40 as compared to other ED fever group, and they had a longer duration of fever. So these are again subtle pointers to differentiate from MISC. We also did an analysis of last year's MISC and dengue, which overlapped during between June and December in the last year. So if you can see again, mucocutaneous presentations are much more common, rash and a conjunctival injection, about 2/3 were MISC as compared to very minimal with dengue, whereas bleeding manifestation, myalgia, hepatomegaly were more common with dengue as compared to MISC. So subtle pointers between differentiating between MISC and dengue. Coming back to the same paper, which described the clinical features from the West, so they also described the laboratory abnormalities. If you see, other fevers had a neutrophil elevation, not as high as what we seen in MISC. So MISC had high neutrophilic leukocytosis, whereas lymphopenia. So the lymphocyte counts are much lower as compared to the other fever group. So lymphopenia with a neutrophilic response was seen more common with MISC. And the CRP was much higher as compared to other fevers. That is again in the Western data. So CRP was in the 200 to 300 in MISC as compared to much lower in their cohort, but their cohort with fever would be probably viral infections as compared to what we see here. In our data also, so hemoglobin was higher in dengue, lymphopenia was seen in both dengue and MISC, but neutrophilic leukocytosis was more commonly seen with MISC as compared to dengue. CRP was way higher as compared to dengue, which had nearly normal CRP. So these are some of the differentiating factors. Still, we erred in many cases. So as Balaji has highlighted one case, I can show you 9 cases out of 102 children we admitted and treated as MISC in the second wave of pandemic. So 7 grew Salmonella typhi on day 3. So diagnosed as enteric fever, 1 E. coli and enterococcus. So out of these 9, 8 received either steroid or IVIG in the initial 24 hours, and then we revise the diagnosis later on. So it is difficult, and probably clinical judgment and possibly more frequent assessment and follow-up is what is going to determine what is the actual diagnosis is. Final thoughts about COVID antibody positive children. So a child comes with some other illness, an acute febrile illness, and you test for COVID antibody, it is positive. What do you do? Whether is it a MISC or MISC with some other fever, or it just the antibody which is triggering an excessive inflammatory response? Do we know any of these? Probably if you ask me one word answer, we don't know. So the antibody COVID anti SARS-CoV-2 antibody, whether it offers cross protection and prevents other infection, or it causes antibody mediated enhancement like what we see in dengue, or it just is a bystander not causing anything to the actual infection. We need more research on this. So I can conclude with only the COVID dengue interaction, which has been highlighted in the recent few years. So the first paper which highlighted the interaction was a Lancet study, which showed a false positive dengue response in a COVID positive patient and misdiagnosed as dengue. So with that, there is another paper from Brazil which showed that patients or population who had previous dengue in the last year had a less severe COVID in the current pandemic. So this was just a population study. It's a hypothesis generating study, but there was no explanation why this happened. So if you see the Indian data, the NVDCP report, if you see a stark decline in the total case of dengue reported from 2019 to 2020, about one third reduction. It was always in the 1 lakh, 1.5 lakhs and 39,000 in the last year. And even in Tamil Nadu, it's 1/4 reduction. Although Chandigarh, a small city, reported similar cases, this can be due to increased attention to the COVID and the dengue being misreported or not being reported, or is there really a COVID protecting against dengue? So with this background, we just did a small observational study of last year, 44 children who presented with dengue in overlap with COVID pandemic. And of 44 children, 15 had SARS-CoV-2 antibody positive, but all behaved like dengue. These were not cases of MISC. So 44, 15 of them had SARS-CoV-2 antibody positive, and the interleukin 11 severity of dengue shock were proportionately same, although renal failure and MODS score or SOFA score was little less in SARS-CoV-2 unexposed children. So, and deaths were also, all the deaths were seen in SARS-CoV-2 unexposed children. So with that, we probably got a hypothesis that maybe SARS-CoV-2 exposure protects against severe dengue. But again, I can't say this because it's a very small cohort and an observational study. And we did not do antibody titers to correlate with the severity. And we did not test at the lab whether there is any cross reaction. So with this thought, I leave you with a summary of undifferentiated tropical fevers. We need to look at the epidemiology and the clinical syndrome. And based on your epidemiology, maybe if it is difficult to identify at the outset, ceftriaxone and doxy is a reasonable choice. And MISC is a diagnosis of exclusion. It is rare. Think of infections first. Enteric fever is a common differential in our cohort. And exposure to SARS and COVID-2 might affect other infections in many ways, but we don't have an answer at this point of time. Thank you for the opportunity. Thanks for having me. I invite questions.
Thank you, Dr. Karthi Nalasamy. You all are amazing. So it's wonderful that from the case scenario which you started and cautioned about various other diseases which can mimic each other and then cause confusion. So we have become much wiser after listening to your talk. I'm sure others also would have been benefited like me. And of course, there is only one question about intravenous administration of doxycycline. Otherwise, I couldn't find in the chat box any other question except the registration for DMC credits. And I would like Dr. Thangavelu to give his comments. Hello, Thangavelu sir.
Yes sir, thank you sir. Thank you sir. Yeah. Wonderful talk sir. Wonderful talk, because we had a lot of doubts about the tropical infections. Very difficult to clinch a diagnosis in the first 3 or 4 days. To complicate the picture, now Nissi also joined. In our this thing, we observed that high CRP and normal CRP and WBC counts to some extent narrowed on the possibilities. High CRP, normal or low count occurs mainly in enteric fever. It correlates very well with culture positivity. Other infections, mostly in scrub and other infections, mostly CRP is associated with the high counts. In dengue, negative CRP, low count. So the high CRP, normal or low count to some extent is able to give us, narrow down the possibility to enteric fever. What is your observation, Kamal sir?
I agree, sir. I think you rightly pointed out the CRP were in those children which we have seen also CRP were more than 200, 300. So in that range as compared to probably other MISC cohort. And although some of them had organ dysfunction, but it is because the cluster of MISC cases during at that time probably initiated therapy for MISC in these children. I think it is prudent to wait for the culture before instituting therapy if the child is stable. So probably that is the message I would give.
So there is a question from the chat box. During dengue epidemic, we had Japanese encephalitis positive cases with a thalamic hypodensity in CT brain. Also, dengue cases had similar CT findings. Can you share your opinion?
Yes, sir. So, fortunately, dengue presenting with an encephalitic presentation, we see very less commonly as compared to encephalitis, which is acute viral encephalitis, which is much more common, probably as compared to southern states, quite common here. So one of the differentiating features which we use at the outset in the emergency room is that any child without any of the systemic features, no thrombocytopenia, no hypoalbuminemia, counts were normal, no coagulopathy or transaminase elevation, only neurological presentation, and presenting with a very severe form of encephalopathy in terms of posturing or GCS less than 9, we attribute more often to an encephalitis, acute viral encephalitis, and JE is quite common. Herpes very less common, and other viruses we don't test here. While dengue presenting with encephalitis, one or the other evidences we generally get like a thrombocytopenia or other systemic features. And I'm saying that we have had dengue diagnosed retrospectively, treated as acute encephalitis, and imaging findings classical with a non-specific encephalitic changes in the basal ganglia or a thalamic region hyperintensities, and getting a dengue positive and retrospectively labeling as dengue. That also happened. Since we don't have a readily antiviral, all of them receive acyclovir, but our proportion of herpes is quite low, maybe 1-2%, we don't unsupportive care.
One more question in the Q&A section is, what do you prefer for meningitis, ceftriaxone alone or ceftriaxone plus vancomycin? Your comments.
Excellent question. So probably as a unit policy, empiric choice, we still start only ceftriaxone to start with. And non-responders are labeled at about 48 hours. Or someone who is already treated outside, presenting with worsening features, and possibly imaging findings are like dense arachnoiditis or features suggesting, pointing towards a pneumococcal meningitis. Most often with the neurology consult, we add vancomycin. So ceftriaxone and vancomycin at about, it's an informed decision taking into consideration. Although the proportion of resistance from the laboratory, we don't get as many pneumococcal resistance to ceftriaxone from microbiology.
Sorry, I'm not able to see in the mobile the question answer. So Ramachandran has given me indication that questions may be there, but in the chat box there is only one question. So if Ramachandran can see the question and answer, if there's any other question, you can answer. But talk was very clear and it has cleared many doubts in the mind.
Dr. Tagavela has already asked those questions.
Yes, those thank questions you. Have already been answered, sir.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Karthita, sir. Really beautiful.
IV doxycycline, I asked, you know, he hasn't mentioned that.
Yes, sir. So all those scrub children with multi organ failure at the outset, we use IV doxycycline. It's available in our institute. So, initial 48 hours, they would be on IV doxycycline, and then we transition to oral once we establish feeds and their GA motility is okay, then probably we switch over to oral doxycycline.
Thank you very much, sir. Excellent talk. So wish you all the best. Yeah.
Thank you, Professor Karthi. It's a wonderful analysis of the cases. Probably tropical infection needs more attention, equally or more than the MISI, I think. Now the MISI is attracting more people, more talk on MISI. Tropical infection still equal or more.